I was thinking in my head, you know, Nantucket has one of the best tournaments all year. And then the Canadian Nationals tournament over the last few years has been labeled as one of the best tournaments all year. And a lot of pros choose whether to, you know, are you making the trek up to the Canadians or are you staying down here, going to the island and playing the Nantucket Open? It's pretty cool that you design both of those courses. You're even designing Prince Edward Island's course, Hillcrest, to be even harder, to make it more challenging, and probably is going to be, pros are going to love it, you know? That's great.
Well, we hope. We hope. And, you know, the thing, it's the truth is, it's hard for me to watch the best players in the world on courses that are designed for basically 950 players.
Yeah. Let's talk about that. Okay. 'Cause you've mentioned it twice now. Let's talk about when you design a course.
I hate ratings talk.
No, we're not going to talk ratings. Ratings are an average. And Chuck, Nick's joking. He doesn't hate ratings talk. Chuck's in here. So listen, this is the inception of disc golf design. A client or a park or whoever it is, however you want to refer to them, reaches out to you, and their initial contact is, "Hey, I want a disc golf course." Your first question that you ask, obviously you probably have, you know, forms and all this, but more or less the first question is like, what are we creating this for, right? I mean, is that where you start?
Well, yes. And like I said, that conversation is typically one that they're having with Dee, because she's, like I said, she's so good at helping understand what they want and helping them understand what we do. So yes, and you know, every once in a while, somebody will say, you know, I want the hardest course in the world, or I want it to be gold. And it doesn't make sense to make a course that's day to day, all the time, gold, right? That's going to challenge the best players in the world, unless you have other configurations that are going to be good for everybody else. So for example, we want to take Hillcrest and make a Hillcrest gold. Harmony Bends has a gold version, and it's in Strawn Park, so we call that turning Strawn into gold. And last year at the Mid-America Open, Emerson Keith, who was at that time just starting a run of just burning it up and was gonna, you know, was about to take the lead at Worlds, he shot a course record 8 under, which was rated 1051. He, over 3 rounds, he averaged 21 under. And I think other than one 20-foot putt, he went bogey-free. So I'm not crazy about the fact that he was able to go pretty much bogey-free. Yeah. But the fact that, you know, averaging 7 under is enough to win a tournament like that, that's, you know, that tells me that we're in the right area where we have goals. I had a conversation, a brief conversation with Paul and Simon on hole 16 at Nantucket, which, if I remember correctly, is where I talked to you for the first time, Matt. I think you were waiting to tee off on hole 16, right? The benches are there.
Crazy. The people get that. To watch. I was just one. Talking about that at the beginning of the show.
Your memory. Sorry. Do people comment on that? Because, and I'm sorry to interrupt midstream there, but do people comment on your ability to remember names and places like that? Because to me, that's more on the difficult side. And you were able to, before I introduced myself recently to get this interview, you remembered me from Nantucket. And that just was, that's impressive to me.
Well, let's give some of the credit to you, because you're an impressive guy. The thing that stuck with me, other than the fact, you know, he's got a beard, I like that. He's a good looking guy. Kids disc golf, I thought was great. So that made awesome. A real impression on me. And so at the same time, forgive me, Nick, if I met you at the same time. And
wait,
I didn't.
No. So Matt was asking, he's like, have you ever met John? And I was like, so I played the Nantucket Open, I think back in 2017. And I think you may have been talking to Paul, and I think I brushed by in conversation, but we've never formally introduced
you.
Yeah, we'll go with that one. Yeah. No, I don't think we've ever formally been introduced with each other. So during pandemic, what better way to do that than on a podcast?
Okay, so we interrupted you. Hole 16.
So we're going back, hole 16.
Yeah, there fist bump. So right, you so saw Simon 16, there.
Right. So Paul and Simon were waiting to tee off. And I said, guys, I just want you to know it's so hard for me to watch you play these 600-foot par fours, you know, because they're not designed for you in this particular venue. We don't have the opportunity to make it longer. And Paul said, and I think I'm pretty close here, Paul said, I think this course is just about perfect for the women.
I will back that up because I actually was there for that conversation. That is almost a direct quote. You're right. That's literally perfect. FPO perfect. Yeah.
Right. And it, because it's, you know, it's meant to challenge people around 950, and that's not a rating thing. That's just a convenient number we use to describe that skill level. Yeah. And anyway, then the kicker is, well, Simon says, I don't know. I kind of like it.
Yeah.
he's trying to go over the top of everything and deuce these 600-foot holes. So
right. It feels good to eagle a hole. So you start with a player in mind when you create a course, and the majority of your courses, that might be hard to specify for you, but the majority of your courses, are they probably focused on that skill level? Are you looking at the amateur level, like 950, 930? Like, is that typically your course design standard?
Again, it depends on the client, because I've done a bunch of 9-hole courses where all the holes are, you know, average 200 feet. And it just depends on what the property is like, what the playing population is like, what their goals are like. But, you know, most of the people who come to us want to have something that's going to bring people into town, you know, something that they can consider a feather in their cap, something their town can be proud of. But as much as possible, we want every course to be as playable as possible for every skill level. So if you look at the red tees at Nantucket, where the par threes are 200 feet and the par fours are 400 feet. So if somebody's just getting started, as soon as they can throw 200 feet accurately, they're going to be able to score on that course. I saw a great post somewhere by a guy who said, I went to play Harmony Bends in Columbia, Missouri, and I ran into a local who said this is the only course he's ever played. Right. And it's the same thing with the red tees there. Yeah. It's a huge park and a huge course, but the red tees, 200 feet on the par threes, 400 feet on the par fours, and about 600 feet on the par fives. So it especially if somebody's coming into the game without any preconceptions, as you would have in golf. Yeah. Right. I mean, golf. The courses are all, you know, total length within a certain range, par within a certain range, fairway widths tend to be within a certain range. And in disc golf, I mean, you never know what you're going to get.
Yeah.
So for somebody who's never played before, and that person goes out to Harmony Bends and is playing these 200-foot holes, 400-foot par fours, they don't necessarily consider it a big deal.